Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to a special edition in our Workplace Spotlight series, Revisions to EEO-1 Reporting, What's the Impact to Employers? We're excited all of you could join us today. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing today's speakers and going over a few housekeeping items, and then we get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. While we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And a PDF of this presentation is available for download in the resource list next to the presentation slides. Before I introduce today's speakers, I just want to quickly review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice. Before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we are discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics. Regulations and legislation change, and employers need to comply with current laws. Also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has over 60,000 employees and over 600,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance responsibilities. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speakers, Ellen Feeney and Elena Almeida. Ellen specializes in healthcare reform, pay equity, the gig economy, and other emerging employer compliance issues. She provides compliance support related to several topics across ADP. She has extensive experience providing training and day-to-day advice on payroll, HR, and ACA compliance. She's a frequent speaker on workplace laws and how they affect employers of all sizes. Elena is an experienced corporate and employment litigation attorney with significant in-house and law firm experience. Her current practice focuses on providing advice and counsel and training on hot topics in employment law with a special interest in pay equity and workplace diversity issues. With Ellen, I know you have a lot to talk about for the next 30 minutes, so I'll turn the event over to you.
Great. Thanks, Karen. Today we're going to cover EEO-1 reporting requirements with a focus on component 2 pay and hours work data and call your attention to the due date, which, you know, seems aggressive. We'll also provide some background on how we got where we are today and an overview of the reporting changes based on what we know today. More information will be coming out from the EEOC, but we at least can cover what we know, you know, as of today and give you an idea of when to expect more information. We'll also review some answers to frequently asked questions. I think we all have a lot of questions when it comes to this. And then we'll conclude with reviewing the impacts to HR processes and data flows, as well as leave you with some final thoughts. So you'll hear us refer a lot to Component 1 and Component 2 today. Component 1 and Component 2 refer to different parts of the EEO-1 form. Component 1 is the EEO-1 form that has been in place for many years and contains HR demographic data. The EEOC has been collecting Component 1 data for decades. For Component 1, an employer lists counts of employees by race and ethnicity in each of 10 EEO-1 job categories. Component 2, though, is what the buzz is all about. It's why we're here today speaking about the EEO-1 form. Component 2 refers to the new pay data and hours work data that has never been collected by the EEOC prior to now. Component 2 goes beyond counts of employees and includes aggregate compensation data from Form W-2 Box 1 and hours work data through the last pay period of the year organized by the 10 EEO-1 job categories, but also by 12 defined pay bands, which we'll go over. You'll also want to take note of the different requirements for filers. Component 1 is required to be filed by employers with 100 or more employees and federal contractors and subcontractors with 50 to 99 employees. Component 2 filing is required for employers with 100 or more employees. We'll provide some more specific information about that, that how you count the 100 employees that's important if you were an employer, that's on the edge of, that 100 employee count. Elaine and I will take us through some of the background and explain how did we get here.
Thanks, Ellen. So before we dive into the details of the EEO-1 reporting requirements, we thought it would be important to take a look back so that you have the context for how we got where we are and what it all means for you. As some of you may recall, the EEOC formally proposed the concept of requiring employers to supplement their traditional EEO-1 filing obligations with pay and hours worked data back in January of 2016, so 3.5 years ago. After a period of comment review, the EEOC asked the Office of Management and Budget, or the OMB, for approval to collect 2 years of pay data through a revised EEO-1 form that would include both Component 1 and Component 2. OMB approved the proposal in September 2016, authorizing the EEOC to collect what we now call Component 2 data through September 30th, 2019. So as of September 2016, the plan was pretty much set. Employers with 100 or more employees would be required to file a new EEO-1 report. For the year 2017, which would be due in March 2018, and for the year 2018, which would be due in March 2019. That didn't happen. Instead, in August of 2017, OMB announced that it had indefinitely suspended or stayed employers' Component 2 reporting requirement. The OMB provided several reasons for this decision, primary among which was that in its view, portions of the new Component 2 requirement lacked practical utility, were unnecessarily burdensome, and did not address privacy and confidentiality issues. At its core, it's widely believed that the decision to stay the Component 2 collection reflected a difference in policy and view between the Obama administration, which proposed the actual rules in 2016, and the Trump administration, which has since taken office. After the stay was announced, several nonprofit organizations, including the National Women's Law Center, sued the EEOC, OMB, and others over the stay. They argued that the OMB stay exceeded its statutory authority. The case went before a district court in Washington, D.C. After discovery and motion practice, the court agreed with the plaintiffs. Judge Tanya Chutkin concluded that OMB had failed to demonstrate it had good cause for staying implementation of Component 2 pay data collection. She, in essence, lifted the stay, ordering OMB and EEOC to launch collection of Component 2 data. So the court's order, which was issued on March 4th of this year, immediately raised additional questions for employers. We now knew that Component 2 was back in play, but we didn't know when the deadline would be for filing this information. Would it be May 31st, 2019, which is the due date for employers to file their Component 1 data? And what years were employers required to report on? Was it the original 2017 and 2018, or would it be some different requirement? And what format were we going to be required to report on? So all of these questions were still open as of the March 4th order. The questions were put to the district court. In April, the court heard arguments about what the EEOC was technically prepared to do and by when. The court eventually ordered the EEOC to collect the Component 2 data for the year 2018 by September 30th, 2019. But recall that the original plan was for the EEOC to collect 2 years of data, 2017 and 2018. the court ordered the EEOC to go ahead and collect a second year of data in addition to 2018. But the court gave the EEOC a choice. The choice was either collect retrospective 2017 data by September 30th, 2019, so to collect both 2017 and 2018 data at once by September 30th, 2019, or the other choice was to collect 2019 compensation data in the normal 2020 EEO-1 reporting period. So that would be due in March 2020. The EEOC chose to require employees to submit 2 years of data in one shot. So now the 2017 and 2018 Component 2 data that was originally envisioned back in 2016, they're both due September 30th, 2019. I should note that and many of you have likely heard that OMB and EEOC have filed a notice of appeal of Judge Chuckin's order, but the EEOC has been very clear that that appeal has no impact and does not stay the September 30th, 2019 deadline. So affected EEO-1 filers should be prepared to submit Component 2 data by that date, regardless of the appeal. So since all this has been happening, the judge has required the EEOC to file periodic status updates with the court, which give us some insight into specifics and details about this process. Some key notes from those updates. The EEOC has retained a third-party vendor to assist it with the technical aspects of collecting and analyzing this extensive data. The EEOC has reported that the portal for collecting Component 2 information will be open and available from July 15, 2019 through September 30, 2019. We are expecting another update from the EEOC tomorrow. One of the things that we're eager to hear is whether the EEOC has been able to open its help desk, which is going to answer questions about the Component 2 requirement. And we'll see if the EEOC has any additional things to report tomorrow. As Ellen mentioned, it's a pretty fluid situation that we have here. That context, we hope is helpful for kind of the details that we'd like to go over now. So Ellen, if I can turn it over to you to go through those specifics about the reporting requirements, both the old and the new.
Sure, thanks, Elena. So this slide shows you, what the requirements are for employers when it comes to, the current Component 1. So for Component 1, employers have to select a workforce snapshot period between October 1st and December 31st. And employers count their employees during the snapshot period. And, each employer gets to choose any pay period during the three-month snapshot period to count its full and part-time employees for the EEOC report. I'm not going to, read through all the bullet points here, but just want to, touch on before I pivot to Component 2 is that, a lot of employers have questions about confidentiality. And so just keep in mind that individual EEO-1 submissions are kept confidential. But, there are some employers that do publicly disclose them on their websites as, evidence of good citizenship. Also, EEO-1 reports may be disclosed pursuant to FOIA requests, Freedom of Information Act requests, submitted to the OFCCP by, federal contractors. But that's something that employers are closely monitoring, especially with the addition of pay and hours work data on the EEO-1 form. So what are the Component 2 requirements? So before I cover specifics, I want to call out that the information we're providing today is based on the sample form and guidance issued by the EEOC in 2016. Back then, the EEOC issued a sample form containing spaces for entering Component 2 data. They also issued a 12-page instruction booklet covering the Component 2 changes and a questions and answers document on the revised EEO-1 and summary pay data. The EEOC will be issuing new guidance, and all indications are that the guidance will be consistent with what was previously issued. We may see some formatting changes to the form, though, since a third party will be collecting the data, but it remains to be seen. You know, before the webinar started, we started to get some questions, and we saw the question, you know, does the earlier template still work? And the content should be the same, but the format may change. You know, we may see a new user interface because this third party is collecting the information, you know, and we're all waiting for the word on the final file specifications, but the content, you know, should be the same, and we should know very, very soon. So employers are required to track pay and hours work data for all full-time, part-time, and variable hour employees throughout the calendar year, and pay is determined by Box 1 W-2 wages. Employers use the same snapshot period they're using today for Component 1, and then year-end pay data permits each employee to be further classified into one of 12 separate pay bands within each job category, and we'll show you what that looks like. Hours work data are aggregated and summarized for each pay, job, and ethnicity category, which will allow the EOC to normalize wage rates between full-time and part-time employees. You know, and as we have covered, you know, the deadline for the new data submission is September 30th, 2019, not 2020, as recently someone was like, surely this has to be September 30th, 2020. No, it's this upcoming September 2019. So, you know, let's look at the changes visually, and the next few slides are, you know, more visual. I mean, the changes are significant. The current form is on the left-hand side here, and you can see it has 10 distinct rows, 14 distinct columns, and additional rows and columns for subtotals, and employee counts are entered into each matrix cell. And the new form on the right, and you know, remember, we're referring to the 2016 sample form issued by the EEOC, has 120 rows now. The 10 job categories are broken into 12 separate pay bands. And the matrix is basically completed twice with employee counts and then also with total hours worked. This slide shows you the 10 job categories on the left-hand side. These are the same job categories used on the current EEO-1 form. And the pay bands that will be on the new form, they're contained on the right-hand side. So, just take a look, but this will also appear on the, the form that gets issued by the EEOC. The additional pay data breakout is into the 12 pay bands that are reported by job category. And so, on the form, under each distinct job category, you will see the list of 12 pay bands. So, for example, on the current EEO-1 form, you have the job category of executive, senior level officials, and managers. On the new form, underneath that will be the breakdown of the 12 pay bands, listed separately, which the employer needs to fill out. So how will this work? The employee's pay data is taken directly from year-end W-2 Box 1, and it's mapped into one of the 12 pay bands. You can see here we have, back from 2016, a sample W-2 form, and then it's that, Box 1 W-2 wages that then will be, mapped and counted in whatever pay band that belongs in. Like I said, the information we're showing you is based on what the EOC issued in 2016. We're pretty confident that the content is going to be the same, but we are going to have to keep a close eye on when the EOC, issues its new guidance, because some of the formatting definitely could change. In terms of hourly, pay data, The EEOC is, requiring on this new report that employers report aggregated hours worked data. And employers are going to tally and report the number of hours worked that year by all employees accounted for in each pay band. So for non-exempt employees, the hours worked are determined by the actual time record. And the EEOC refers to the definition of hours worked consistent with the FLSA. For exempt employees, you use actual hours if recorded, or if you're not recording your exempt employees' exact hours worked, you use a proxy of 40 hours for full-time employees and 20 hours for part-time. And then the annual work hours are aggregated for all employees in a snapshot. And you can see on the right-hand side here, hourly totals are broken out and entered into the same matrix categories that correspond to the employee count. So hopefully some of those visuals are, helpful. And, if you were tracking this back in 2016, it's coming back to you. So next we're going to, cover some frequently asked questions that employers have. So you will note that on the bottom of these slides, we note that the responses are based on 2016 EEO-1 form and guidance. I just want to emphasize again that we're waiting for the EEOC to issue a sample form and guidance. And, every indication is that the EEOC will follow what it set forth in 2016, but you're going to want to be certain to check for the latest guidance before submitting your EEO-1 forms with component 2 data. So, Elena, why don't you take us through, the first few questions?
Sure. Thanks, Ellen. And I know that that was very helpful information on the proxy hours because we've had several questions from people on what to do if you're not tracking hours. The another kind of general set of questions we get is kind of identifying changes in a worker's status over the course of a year. The focus is on the employee status as of the date of the snapshot. So for the snapshot period. If an employee is exempt at the snapshot date, then he or she is exempt for purposes of component 2, even if that status was different earlier in the year. Similarly, the snapshot date is important for, and it's the key for determining the number of employees for the report, which might make a difference, particularly if as Ellen mentioned earlier, you're on sort of the cusp of whether or not you need to be a filer at the 100 employees or more. So the number of employees is the number that are active at the time of the snapshot. This is also specifically a question that we keep getting about from employers with seasonal employees. So for schools and summer camps who may have a swell in headcount over one part of the year and then reduce back to a much smaller headcount at other times of the year, what do those employers do for numbers? Again, unless the seasonal workers are on the payroll at the time of the snapshot, they don't need to be included in the EEO-1 reporting. And as you'll note in the on the slide, this is consistent with EEO-1 instructions for other parts of the EEO-1 filing.
Apologies, everyone. I think we lost our speakers. I'm reaching out to them right now to see if we can get them back online. Hopefully we'll have them on in a couple minutes. I apologize for the inconvenience. And just as a reminder, too, a PDF of the presentation is available for download. We'll make sure that we cover all the slides today, even if we go over a little bit. And an on-demand version will be available. Ah, there you are.
Hey,
I'm glad you're back. Okay, I apologize to the audience. So I will let you continue on slide 19 with your hours worked slide.
Okay, great. And so this is a question we see a lot, just about what hours worked need to be reported. And the EOC refers to the FLSA definition of hours worked, which wouldn't include PTO. This only includes the time, as defined under the FLSA when employees are suffered or permitted to work. So it wouldn't include hours paid when the employee was on, PTO. We also have seen questions about how would piecework be administered. And keep in mind that the FLSA requires employers to track actual work hours for non-exempt workers performing piecework, so the employer would actually report those actual work hours. Another question we see is about the use of standard hours. Is it possible to use standard hours instead of the 40 hours, 20 hours proxy that the EOC has defined? And, you shouldn't be using standard hours absent additional guidance and clarification from the EOC. There doesn't appear to be any direct support for using standard hours, but that's something, once we receive up dated guidance from the EOC that we'll be, looking for closely. Also another question has to do with calculating earnings. So if the hours worked in 1 year are paid for in the following calendar year, are they reported with the 2017 or the 2018 EEO-1 report? Do you report those hours worked in the reporting year in which the pay was received for those hours? And so back, in 2016, when the EOC issued revised instructions, they stated if wages are actually paid in the next calendar year for work done in the last days of the past calendar year, those hours would be counted in the next year because it's the way the pay is reported, on the W-2. So we just have, two slides, substantive slides left. And this slide shows how much the change in requirements, to now include pay data and hours work data results in a much longer and much more complicated EEO-1 report. The content of the sample form issued in 2016, we're saying the content should remain the same, but the format's likely to change. The required submission has grown from a 120-cell matrix containing only employee counts to over a 3,000-cell matrix, including hours worked in addition to employee counts. So instead of just pulling from HR demographic data to complete the form, employers now have to pull in data from their payroll system and potentially their time and labor system to gather hours worked. And when you think about, organizational readiness to meet the EEO-1 deadline, a good place to start is, has anyone, asked the payroll function at your organization about how to access and pull form W-2 box 1 data? It's going to be challenging given the requirement to pull in and report 2017 data. Retroactive data is generally a challenge. If the updated form issued by the EOC is similar to their 2016 version, there will be a comment field, and you may want to consider adding some remarks or relevant information to the filing. There's not a lot of space on that EEO-1 form for remarks, but it's worth, considering providing some caveats, but you'd want to discuss that with your employment counsel. The EOC, as we've mentioned, is outsourcing the entire component to pay and hours work data reporting function, you know, including servers, communications with employers. The burden on employers is real. We could see some employers challenge the component to collection in court, since reporting pay data by pay bands won't necessarily assist the EOC's non-discrimination mission. But more to come on that. You know, the situation, as we have said, is fluid, but employers should prepare to comply. You know, if you're an ADP client who currently has access to EEO-1 reporting in your product that you're using, our product teams are working on updates, and you'll start to see communications about, you know, the exact timing, in upcoming releases. So now I'm going to turn it back to Elena for some final thoughts for today. Definitely not the final word on this topic.
No, absolutely not. And we're going to continue to provide updates to you and our traditional channels as this continues to develop over the course of the summer. But takeaways, the component one, the traditional demographic data for the year 2018 is due next week, May 31st. The component two data is due September 30th, 2019, and that's going to cover 2 years, 2017 and 2018. We also would be remiss if we didn't kind of highlight the fact that today we were talking about EEO-1 requirements, but we want to underscore that employers should be focusing not only on complying with these requirements, but also on pay equity issues more broadly. There's been a lot of activity at the EEOC and also in the individual states that focuses on equal pay, pay transparency, and other practices like salary history bans and those issues. So we encourage all employers to conduct privileged pay audits and examine their pay practices and policies to remain in compliance overall in this important area. Thank you so much for your help today. Karen, if you could help close us out for the day.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much, Ellen and Elena, for all that valuable information. So that does conclude our event for today. If you'd like to receive ongoing communications from ADP on this issue and other regulatory and legislative topics, please subscribe to our Eye on Washington email alerts by visiting the link shown on the screen or indicate you'd like to opt in on the event survey. And for more workforce trends and insights, we encourage you to visit our ADP blog link shown on the screen and to register for more additional Workplace Spotlight webinars as well. And again, thank you so much for sticking with us through those audio issues. I hope you found this information valuable. And on behalf of Ellen, Elena, myself, and the entire team at ADP, we thank you for joining us today and look forward to having you join us for future Work Spotlight events. Thank you and have a great rest of your day.